Howdy once again, it's Tubal Cain, your YouTube shop teacher, also known as Mr. Pete 222. And in this video and the following one, I'm going to show you how to sharpen dull drill bits with the Lyle number 91,000 drill bit grinder. There's the directions, so you'll need the directions or just watch this video, but you can also download the directions from the Lyle website. You'll also need some drill gauges like that. A can full or box full of dull drill bits, and every machine shop has hundreds of dull bits, don't we? Stay with me. If you haven't already watched them, check out these five videos where I restore the Lyle drill grinder. Let me caution you before we start that a grinder is always dangerous with the grit and the spark, so make sure you wear your safety glasses, use this safety shield, although I will be taking this off for clarity, but I will be wearing a face shield, and I recommend you wear a face shield and or goggles when you're doing this. You just can't be safe enough. You can't gamble your eyes. But the very first thing we're going to do, and then the dust and the sparks really fly, is to dress the wheel. And the purpose of dressing the wheel, even though this is almost a brand new wheel, is to shape it and to sharpen it. And yes, a grinding wheel does get dull. So the first thing we do is take the actual fixture off that holds the drill bits, set that off to the side. And this is the diamond. It's brand new, still has the protective cover on. That's the actual diamond nib right there. And all we're going to do is move that back and forth across the wheel, and it fits right in the split fixture here. And notice that there is a groove here, or an index mark, that lines up with the index mark on this aluminum split fixture here. By the way, as I use this grinder, you'll see that there might be differences between this one and the one that you have. For instance, many of the more recent models are hexagon here rather than round. But I simply take the diamond fixture here, install it, line up the index marks, and tighten the bolt. And some of these will have a square bolt here, or they might even have a hex key type bolt, a cap screw. So I'll tighten that down real well. This knurled knob is the feed screw that moves the diamond in and out. And then with this lever, we're going to move the diamond back and forth slowly across the wheel, taking very, very light cuts, just a little bit at a time. Make sure the diamond is not touching the wheel, and then I can turn the motor on. So now the wheel is square and sharp and ready to use. There are no grooves in it. Now if you've got grooves, you want to take the grooves all the way out. The next thing I'm going to do, and I hate to do it because I think it's a bad example, but I am going to remove the guard simply for the purposes of photography, but I will be wearing my full face shield as I do this demonstration. The Lyle grinder is not all that hard to use, but there is a definite learning curve. And you need to practice it with it as well. You're probably going to have some bad grinds to start with. And be sure and watch the previous video on the geometry of the drill bit so you know what to be looking for as you grind the bits. Now there are a lot of adjustments to make. Most of them are on this fixture that holds the drill bit. As we install this into the split clamp here, there's a groove and this is a ball detent. So upon assembling this, I can feel it when the ball hits the groove. This whole device here is called the feed bracket, but it consists of several parts. Right here we have the feed, and that's what moves the drill bit in and out from the wheel. It also was used for the diamond dresser. We can lock it in a given position, and there's a little spring-loaded collar here. I'll talk more about that in just a minute. And then, of course, we have the lever here that moves it back and forth across the wheel. The entire feed bracket here can be moved back and forth in this large slot, but on this particular model I have to get at it from underneath, and there's a nut with holes in it, and I use a punch to loosen that up, and this can be moved back and forth depending on the diameter of the drill bit. Now I'm going to start out with half inch drill bits, and I have it adjusted for that, but you can see there's some little witness marks here that I have marked, and that's probably for when we're grinding larger drill bits than what we're going to start out with here. So I'm going to be grinding half inch bits and then back down to quarter inch and then up to three quarters or 1 inch or so, something in that neighborhood. The capacity of the machine is anywhere between eighth inch drill bits and inch and a quarter. But I suggest you stay away from small drill bits. Throw them away. They are disposable. They are consumable. And do not bother with anything under quarter inch unless you have very good eyes and a lot of patience. I have tipped the entire machine on its side, or tilted it up just a little bit so I can show you something. But on most of these machines, there will be a sticker right here. This one has the number stamped on it. Remember, this is a particularly old machine. It probably is one of the earlier ones. But someone has marked this over the years with a V, and there's your witness mark right there. And that is the 59 degree mark. It doesn't agree with the original stamped one. And there's some other marks on here. I don't know what they're for, but possibly for special drill bits that they were grinding in that shop wherever this came from. So what you have to do here is to loosen up this half inch bolt or whatever bolt yours has and set it for 59 degrees, but more than likely yours will be already set on 59 because 90% or 95% of everybody that uses these will be grinding their drill bits at the most common angle, which is 59 degrees. So that's the very first thing to check. Alright, my first grind is going to be this poorly ground and dull half-inch drill bit, so I need to set the fixture for a half-inch bit, and there are several things that you need to do here, and we'll start by adjusting this for the size. So loosen up this half-inch bolt, it may vary on yours. That allows this to swing back and forth, but the first thing we'll do is to loosen up this little screw, and this is an adjustment for the angle of the lip clearance. And there's really three positions here. The top one, way up there if you can see it, is for grinding an 18 degree clearance angle. Well, that's way too steep. Way down at the bottom is for only 6 degrees. That would be for larger bits, like 1 inch bits, but we're right about in the middle for a half inch bit. And I will tighten that down. And next, while I still have this bolt loose, you're going to find that there's a sticker on the top here. It's kind of hard to read. I would like to replace it, but you can see that there's a half inch there. So I'll set the witness mark right on the half and tighten this down with the wrench. And then it's set for half, and that probably will work for bits that are just a little bit above or below half inch as well. And you can see again, here's the capacity, eighth up to inch and a quarter. First, let me explain something. Every one of these grinders came with a little magnetic gauge. They were usually lost the first day. I do not have one, but I took an old penny here. I drilled a hole and I put a pin in there. And in the original, the brass pin there would be a magnet. And on one side, the magnet stuck out 1/8 of an inch. On the other side, 3/32 of an inch. And the purpose of that was to set right on the guide here with the magnet that would hold it in place and bring the drill bit up to the gauge. And there is a picture of that, but I'm going to teach how to use this without this gauge because it's something that gets lost, and I think just by common sense you can get along without it. Otherwise you've got to buy a whole bag of them because you're going to lose them. I suppose I might as well show you this right now. It's in the direction, but there is the little gauge with the man's finger on it right here, and that's being held up to the tip of the drill bit, if you can tell that. It's pretty hard to see, but we would use the 3/32 side of it for bits up to 3/8 of an inch, and we would flip it over to the other side, the 1/8 inch side, for bits that are over 3/8. And that distance is really fairly important, and it will change depending on how much you grind off the end of the bit, or how badly damaged the bit is. Now, this drill bit isn't in too bad of a condition, but if you have a drill bit that is badly damaged and you need to remove part of it, it ought to be done on the offhand grinder, not on the Lyle drill grinder. Otherwise you're going to have to reposition the drill bit many times in this fixture. But again, here's how to make the adjustments now for this 1/2 inch bit. Now, when we get ready to grind a bit, if you have one that is badly damaged or dull and it's just ruined clear down here, you need to grind that off on the offhand grinder. Otherwise you have to reposition it too many times in the Lyle grinder. But the first thing we have to do here with this lip stop is loosen up these two screws, I've already done that, and swing it all the way to the right. Now, I've taken a Sharpie and I made that mark there, but there is a little scratch, a little groove made from the factory. It was hard to see, so I just highlighted it. Now I will loosen the clamp here and rotate the drill so that the lip is parallel with that black line. Then I can snug it up. Now this will move in and out depending on the size of the drill bit. Gotta loosen that up just a little bit. Got it tight. Moves in and out. And then when I swing it over to touch the edge of the drill bit here, I want to just barely catch it. That's a little bit too much, so I'll back it off so it's just touching, and then I'll tighten this screw. And make sure that both of these screws are tight. The purpose, again, of this little magnet gauge was to check to see if it laid right there, that the drill bit was sticking up 1/8 of an inch. Now this is over 3/8 diameter, so you can see I have approximately 1/8 of an inch sticking up over the little gauge right here. Now looking at the bottom here, I bring the stop up against and tighten it, and I would make an adjustment here if it was needed, but that's just to support it. So get it about in that position right there. For real small drill bits, we would reverse this and this pin would come up for perhaps a 3/16 drill bit, because those bits are so short. And for real short bits, you might have to remove this intermediate guide. Let me review this real quickly, because this is a difficult concept. I do have the clamp tightened, but after I grind the first lip, then I will loosen the clamp. You have to take the fixture out to do this. Rotate it 180 degrees, and with the clamp just snug, bring it up against, and then you will have repeatability and both lips the same, and it, all the time the end of the shank is touching the stop. Now what I showed you may seem complicated, but you can do it in a matter of a minute or so. Now with the drill bit in position here, we can assemble it. Feel that click in. Find a spot on the wheel where you're going to work and position it such that none of the guide here or a portion of the jig is going to hit the wheel and self-destruct. Now we can move in, and when we get close, I can see I need to move it out here a little bit, and that's the position that I'm going to work in. Right there, I'm fairly close to the wheel. Now I'm going to turn the machine on, get my face guard on. And here we go. First lip is completed. I'm going to take it out and rotate it for the next lip. But before I do, let's look down here. And remember, I've been feeding in with this. Before I back it out, I will lock it. And there's a spring-loaded collar here, and you'll see that that stays in position. So I back that way out, so that I can remove the drill bit. Looking good. Might be a little excessive relief. And I bring it in again right to that little finger till I feel it touch. Tighten it. And again, I'm down on the stop here. Reinsert it. I'm ready to grind this side, this lip. You cannot see what my left hand is doing, but I'm constantly moving this in just a little bit to move the drill bit into the grinder, but I will feel it when it hits the stop collar, and I know that I am done and can take the drill bit out. Take it out and look at it. All right, here it is, and it's kind of a rusty drill bit, but it looks very good. Both lips are even. Be very careful you don't overheat your drill bit and turn it blue or lose the temper. Using the 59 degree gauge here, you can see that I'm just about on. I'm going to take this out to the comparator here in a minute, the shadow graph. And that the clearance, this is set for 6 degrees. The clearance is approximately 6 degrees. Anyway, that's not a good protractor to check it with, but it's a little clumsy. And now, checking the chisel point with the 135 degree protractor, you can see I got a lot of shadow there, that I'm pretty close. Again, I think I said it already, both lips are equal and that everything is cleaned up. Now, if you weren't able to clean it up, that is, you'll see some of the old material still there and it's out on the heel, it doesn't really matter, but for your own satisfaction, you might want to make it look like this one. Let's go out to the shadow graph. We're at the Shure Tomiko optical comparator, and there's the drill bit. And rather than put the gauge up here, which was kind of difficult because I can't get the correct focus because they're different distances away. Focal lengths vary. So I'm doing it down here on the screen with a transparency. Let me turn the house lights off. Looking on the screen now, this is really just a shadow, that's why they call it a shadow graph, of the point of the drill bit, and I made up a gauge. Some of these comparators have angles on here, and matter of fact, this one does, but not 118 degrees, so I had to make this up, and you can see that it pretty well coincides. And, you know, the Lyle drill grinder is a nice machine, but I would say that it's still not the quality of the drill bit grinders that they would use at a Cleveland twist drill. But you can see that I'm pretty darn close to the 118, and I made another gauge as well, but I think the transparency works better. Now, you're not going to have a comparator at home, I know, but I'm doing this just for the fun of it. As you go through your drill bits and recondition them, some of them are going to have shanks that are all marred and torn up like this. Don't take them to the grinder or even the belt sander. Put them into your three-jaw chuck like this. Just take some of that. Remember, the shank is soft compared to the other end, and give them a quick filing. And you're just trying to get the high spots off, not the low spots. In the holder, I have another half-inch drill bit in need of sharpening, and I'm going to do it, but this will be all sped up, but that way you can watch what both of my hands are doing. Now, I've already moved the lever in so that the drill bit is in the right position on the wheel. And generally, we work toward the left side on the worn, on the smaller drill bits, and that causes a great deal of wear, really, because we're not using the other side. Now I have to rotate the bit. And here I am on the other side, the other lip. And there's another one, and it looks good. Notice there's no discoloring, that is no blue color from overheating. Make sure you use the right grade of wheel, recommended by Lyle. And that concludes this episode on using the Lyle drill grinder. Tune in for the next episode where I will grind both smaller bits and larger bits than the half inch. Thanks for watching.